In 1992, Reservoir Dogs was released and quickly became known as one of the greatest indie films of all time, and it introduced the world to Quentin Tarantino, who would go on to make such films as Pulp Fiction, The Hateful Eight, Inglourious Basterds, and his most recent work, Once Upon a Time in Hollywood. The film did well with audiences and critics alike, and even scored a theatrical release despite it being an indie film that had a budget of only $1.2 to $1.5 million. And for those of you wondering, Pulp Fiction, a movie that's known to have a lower-end budget for a feature-length film, had a budget of $8.5 million, $7 million more than what was projected for Reservoir Dogs. Despite having a low budget, however, Reservoir Dogs still delivers a lot of drama, suspense, action, and a ton of blood and gore that Tarantino quickly became known for. So today, we're going to dive headfirst into Reservoir Dogs and try to explain why it's so great. My name's Mr. Cow, let's get this underway. First things first, we need to talk about the storytelling of Reservoir Dogs, because it's told in a non-linear structure, much like Pulp Fiction, but on a smaller scale. Non-linear, of course, meaning, in conventional terms, the movie's somewhat out of order. It's not told in a straight line, and you're kind of given information when the story says you're allowed to have that information, instead of in the order the events play out. Now, in a movie like Pulp Fiction, it was kind of an artistic choice, while also serving the story incredibly well when it came to suspense and drama and just general audience intrigue. In Reservoir Dogs, the movie had an incredibly small budget, which we've already stated, and because of that, a lot of the movie takes place in this warehouse. If the movie were to play out exactly in order, the last good chunk of the movie would be inside this warehouse, which would get a little bit boring after a while. Even though the story's interesting, it'd be nice to have a change of scenery. And I think Tarantino knew this when he was writing the script. I think he knew that he wasn't going to have the biggest budget ever to tell the story, so he kept things small, and decided to tell it in the structure so that while things were going on inside of this warehouse, you could also have these other tidbits going on, explaining characters, explaining how the story's unfolding, and a bunch of stuff like that. So the non-linear storytelling of Reservoir Dogs definitely helped keep the story interesting, especially on such a small budget with so few places to shoot at, and otherwise I don't think Reservoir Dogs would really have been that interesting of a movie to watch, just because it would get a little bit monotonous after a while. That being said, Tarantino's writing fits perfectly with non-linear storytelling because he focuses on not just telling the story, but also world-building with his Tarantino dialogue, which is a concept we've already touched on in our Pulp Fiction review, but just to re-explain things a little bit, Tarantino dialogue is disconnected sort of dialogue that doesn't really have to do with the main story of the movie, but has to do with building characters and building the world and helping everything feel grounded and real. The very first scene of this movie is all about that kind of dialogue. It's just building some of the characters, building the world, and helping make everything feel realistic. It's helping keep the stakes high because you feel like these are real people. And then it's followed by a scene that's iconic in filmmaking, which is the walkout scene paired with Little Green Bag with the title sequence right after it. You've already seen the scene in this video right at the beginning, and I still can't explain why it's so great. The music just fits with the feeling. You get the feeling of these criminals. They all think that they're big, tough guys, badasses. I'm not 100% sure. It's really hard to explain why this scene is so great. I want to say it's just because of the music, but it's probably not. I wish I had a better explanation for you guys for why this scene was so iconic and why it's so pleasing to watch paired with the music, but I can't. It's just one of those things that's really good, and it's kind of hard to explain why. And if you don't like it, that's fine, because I can't explain to you why you should like it, so we'll just move on. Now, we've already kind of touched on this aspect when we've talked about Tarantino's dialogue, but the realism in his films is sometimes a little bit off-putting, especially when it comes to characters in the film being shot or hurt in some way. The actors really do act like they have been shot or hurt. It's something I've heard a lot when I'm showing people Tarantino movies for the first time. They're kind of shocked that there are these people screaming and grunting, especially in movies like Django Unchained or Reservoir Dogs, where right after the iconic walkout scene, you get to see a character kneeling over in pain bleeding everywhere in the back of the car, screaming about how he's dying. It really is intense, it grabs the attention of the viewer, and it sets the stakes that much higher, that this is a realistic setting, despite it being out of our world in most cases, unless you're a criminal who robs stores for diamonds, which would be cool, so you could relate to it in that sense, but it still makes the world feel real. And Reservoir Dogs being Tarantino's first film, it was really impressive to see this still being in his films at this point in time. When people get hurt, when people get shot, they act like it. And you gotta be a really special director to get that point across. And even saying it out loud right now, it sounds kind of stupid to say, oh, you have to be a good director to have your actors act the way they're supposed to act. But it's something we see so rarely in films. People who get hurt actually acting like they got hurt. It's something that you pretty rarely see. The most recent one I've seen was in 1917. And even then, it wasn't too crazily carried out throughout that film. Set in World War I, the feeling of pain after being shot or stabbed or hit over the head with something needs to be present throughout your entirety of the movie to help it feel grounded and real, unless that's not where you're going for and you're trying to make some kind of action movie or superhero movie or something like that. It needs to feel realistic if you're trying to make a realistic feeling movie. Tarantino's dialogue and Tarantino's directing just in general does a great job of pulling out this realism from all the actors and the scenery that's around. It just does a great job of pulling in the audience and making you feel like this is something that could actually happen in our world. Tarantino's music choice in Reservoir Dogs is also especially interesting because it's all based around this radio station, The Sounds of the 70s, and the music he picks out for each scene seems to perfectly fit that scene, although sometimes it doesn't really make sense why. The song doesn't have some underlying meaning that fits in with the scene, like with Little Green Bag and the walkout scene. It just fits, and it doesn't make a lot of sense, but it works really well. That's just using music to your best advantage. It's like he was looking around for specific songs that would almost fit the vibe or the creepiness of some scenes, like the infamous ear-cutting scene in Reservoir Dogs, which I'm not even allowed to show, I don't think, any of on YouTube, or at least any of the aftermath of it on YouTube, just for copyright and gore reasons, I should also say. But that scene especially is so eerie and creepy as the music in the background is stuck in the middle with you. It's so bizarre, but it fits so perfectly. I will say this, however, the very last song of the movie played during the end credits, Coconut, doesn't feel like it fits at all. I'm really kind of confused by it. I had this idea I wanted to incorporate in the video where the music, even though it didn't really fit with what was going on in the scene and how it fitted with the vibe, was kind of like how criminals didn't really fit in our society, but they looked like us. I'm not 100% sure. I didn't fully formulate that thought. But this final song during the end credits just doesn't really work. It doesn't capture the feeling of the movie. It's a song that fits within the genre of the 70s, but it just doesn't really feel like it fits as well as all of the other ones. So I'm not going to say this movie is perfect, because that is one aspect I don't really like about it. The end credits song, believe it or not. Everything else I'm pretty much okay, or I loved it at this point. But it's almost like the music of the world in Reservoir Dogs, even though it fits with the timeline and somewhat what's going on in the world, it doesn't fit in so much with our characters because they're evil people, I guess is the point I'm trying to get at. While the music is music we probably all know and love from the 70s, 70s hits, these songs, when applied to this kind of criminal world, is just bizarre. It fits in really well, but it doesn't really attribute the right kind of meaning to it, if that makes sense. It's really hard for me to explain because I'm not entirely sure what I'm trying to explain. I know the music works in this movie because every single scene where a new 70s song comes on from that radio station that they're talking about in the film, it pushes that scene up in quality. It really does. The music helps make this movie. And I'm looking for some underlying reason, but maybe there isn't one. Maybe sometimes music in a movie is there just to kind of set the mood, or give you something to listen to make a scene a little bit more enjoyable. I'll have to do more research on music and filmmaking to really understand why it fits so perfectly in these scenes. All I know for right now is I really enjoy it, and I'm sure you guys will too. The last thing I want to talk about in this video is how the four main criminals, Mr. White, played by Harvey Kittle, Mr. Blonde, played by Michael Madsen, Mr. Orange, played by Tim Roth, and Mr. Pink, played by Steve Buscemi, those four criminals, the four main ones with the most screen time, kind of embody all these different types of criminals and kind of represent these different mindsets when it comes to being a professional criminal. Mr. White is the old-timer kind of criminal. He does things the old-fashioned way, but he also lets himself open up to Mr. Orange, who seems like the first-year criminal, the beginner. But at the same time, Mr. Orange is the undercover cop. That one's balancing and reaching a little bit, but it definitely gets hammered home more when we talk about Mr. Blonde and Mr. Pink. Mr. Blonde is the psychopath. He enjoys torturing people, he enjoys violence, he gets a genuine enjoyment out of doing pretty much genuinely evil things. And that's why he becomes sort of the antagonist of the movie as things move along. Whereas Mr. Pink, and I stand by this theory to this day, is the professional criminal. He makes it clear at the beginning of the movie where he talks about he doesn't tip waitresses unless they do something above and beyond to impress him, something that he hadn't seen before or something he wasn't expecting them to do. And because of that, even when he's being convinced by other people to leave a tip because their boss told them all to contribute to the tip, he has no compassion for the lives anyone else around him is living. He's looking out only for himself, unless someone does something above and beyond to prove to him that they may deserve something a little bit extra. It's further cemented down when Mr. White is slowly but surely showing more affection to Mr. Orange and thinking that there's no way he could be an undercover cop, when in reality he is the undercover cop. And Mr. Pink calls him out and says that he's acting like a first-year criminal, where he himself is acting like a professional. And here's where this theory all comes together. I believe Mr. Pink, the only person we don't see die really in this movie, other than I believe Mr. Blue, I believe he kind of, I think, makes it out alive at the end of this movie. I have no proof for it. It's just my assumption based on the way the characters are played out. Mr. Blonde's psychopathic nature gets him killed by Mr. Orange. Mr. Orange, being an undercover cop and semi-inexperienced, gets killed by Mr. White, who then in turn gets killed for killing Mr. Orange, for letting himself become open to this person without thinking that he could be someone who's going against him, I guess, in that way. So those three main characters die, but Steve Buscemi, we never see him die. In fact, he grabs the diamonds and runs, and then the cops come in. Maybe he got shot on the way out, but I'd like to think that the idea is the professional criminal, the person who can keep their cool, comes out on top. And in fact, in Tarantino's first two films, Pulp Fiction and Reservoir Dogs, keeping your cool is kind of a big deal. It's something that's brought up a lot in Pulp Fiction and a lot in Reservoir Dogs. If you don't keep your cool, you can get seriously hurt or almost definitely killed in both of these scenarios, in both of these movies. Mr. Pink, Steve Buscemi's character, keeps his cool and makes it out, to what I believe, alive. I could be wrong about that, but it was something super interesting to watch play out with these characters. They all get their own little bit of screen time explaining themselves, even though Mr. Pink doesn't have his own little scene with Joe, the boss, who's running the operation. Even though he doesn't have that scene and all the other characters that I just mentioned do, we still get this fleshed out feeling about him with the diner scene, with another scene where he's running away from the cops after the robbery. You just get this feeling that he is, in fact, the professional criminal. That's what I believe. If you think I'm wrong, perfectly fine. If you haven't seen the movie, watch it and let me know what you think. It's a theory, but it's definitely something that intrigues me, that these four characters were so unique and so engaging, while also being so completely different, but being forced to be put together by their boss, Joe, to carry out this job. I thought it was a really interesting aspect of this movie, especially the psychopath stuff with Mr. Blonde. Reservoir Dogs did a great job of capturing all these different kinds of criminals, putting them together to carry out this one job, and then kind of showed what happens when you don't keep your head and you let yourself open up. Whatever the scenario is, it shows what happens, and the end result is usually death or failure, but mostly death, with a lot of blood and gore and a lot of screaming. Tarantino's first film, Reservoir Dogs, is truly a sight to behold when it comes to how low the budget was and how much he was able to accomplish. There is so much going on and there's so much to be intrigued by that people are still talking about it to this day as one of the greatest indie films of all time. And I have to agree, it is one of the finest films I think I have ever seen in my life, let alone one of the best indie films I've ever seen. With that all being said, I hope today I've been able to explain to you why Reservoir Dogs is so great, and if you haven't seen it yet, I would highly recommend you check it out. It's a great movie. As for more Tarantino content, I guess, if you want to know more about Quentin Tarantino, I already reviewed Pulp Fiction, my favorite movie of all time on this channel. It'll be linked at the end here in just a second for you to check out. Thank you all very much for watching. Next up, not 100% sure. I'm either going to talk about a certain movie that came out very recently that I believe is incredibly overrated, or a certain old movie that is overrated, but I agree with its overratedness, and we're going to talk about it in a positive light. We'll see what happens, and I'll see you guys then. Goodbye.